Well, hello there again, my YouTube friends. I'm just at the bench today because I want to make up a few more cables for my test gear. It's quite easy. I just thought I'd bring you along and show you how I make them. Okay, so before I go on to the making of my cables for my test gear, I was just going to do a bit on spudgers and pry tools that you use for phone openings. I get asked sometimes what spudgers you use, what levers I use, for opening things, electronic devices and stuff like that. So I've never done a video on spudgers. It seems such a basic thing, and everybody uses them. Well, most people use them if they're into electronics repair. You'll find the people who aren't into electronics repair will use a screwdriver or something like that, especially if it's on an Xbox or something. But the ideal thing to use is spudgers. So we'll have a look at some of these I've bought in a minute, but first I'll go over some of the ones I've got and I use, and hopefully it might help somebody out, or help somebody, with what to look for when they're looking for spudgers for their little shop or, business or whatever. So the first thing you'll normally come across are these things. Everybody's seen these. You get them virtually with every phone repair screen. Or every spare screen you get or new screen you get for a phone. They come in a little bag. They come as free tools, with a couple of screwdrivers, and they're handy tools for one-off jobs. If you only have to do one screen, these will do just fine, or a couple of screens even. Once you move up from these, you'll find that you'll end up with where are my flat spudgers? These ones. I still use these all the time. These are the standard type. You get a point on one end and a sort of lever on the other end. These are a bit, you could do with changing these, but these are much stiffer than these ones. These are quite flexible. These are a bit more industrial. They're all available on eBay, places like that, AliExpress, and they're very cheap. To move up a bit further, oh, to go back a bit further, let's take a step backwards to the very basic spudgers again. Instead of using these for opening phone screens and stuff like that, these tend to be a bit thick. You can get away with them, but you wouldn't be able to open a phone with this, really. So you're better off getting yourself some guitar picks. Now these are very thin. These are half a millimeter. You can see how narrow they are. They're very narrow, but these are no good for initially prying screens off. They're too thin. So what you're best doing is getting something like this, which are, I think they're half millimeter steel guitar picks. As I say, all available on eBay. They're good. I use them quite often to get into phones or anything that's, that's a bit tricky to get into. But they're always handy to have them. They're disposable, so you can buy them in, packs of hundreds. And they last you, a good long time. And then there's other ones, different varieties, like razor blade ones. These, they're sort of like razor blades. They have got a sharpish edge, two sharpish edges, and these are good for scraping plastic off screens, or the gaskets that go behind screens. These are good for digging that out, if you don't want to use a screwdriver or something like that. You're always best using plastic anyway, because there's less chance of you causing any damage. And then we go on to like these sort of things, which are like very flimsy teardrop things. These are good for getting behind screens, but these are literally only a couple of use things. These are very thin, probably 0.4 of a millimeter, something like that. And then we move on to industrial spudgers, which, well, those are sort of industrial spudgers, which every shop, hobbyist will have. Then we go to the metal type spudgers, which are that type, a bit more stiff. You can get varying stiffnesses of these, depends on where you get them from. Some are better quality than others. I can't really recommend a place because I've bought them from a few places, and it's just the look of the drawer, with what thickness you get. Then we move on to these type of things, which are just flexible steel spudgers. All good, all usable, always handy to have them. And then up to the sort of proper industrial type spudges, which are more like pry bars and levers. These are big, like thick levers. You pull nails with these. These are absolutely solid, as are these. I think these originally were tire levers, but I've modified these. They're actually really, really sharp on the edges. And what I use these for, if I'm not using them for just for levering, I'm using these for, you know, the tape that holds iPhone batteries in, the sort of the adhesive tape, this stuff, that for behind batteries. I'll use it to get this stuff out, because the genuine iPhone adhesive behind batteries, you can normally, it's virtually unusual to snap that. If you're used to doing it, you can normally get that out in one go all the time, unless you rub it against the, like, the Taptic feedback device inside the iPhone. That will tend to cut it if you rub it against it. But you know, for getting these ones out, if these have been installed, I tend to lever a battery up with heat. I'll use this this hot mat for, you know, heating the phone up, then get behind the battery with one of these big plastic spudges, and then I'll use the edge of one of these, which is, these are quite sharp. If you look at them, they're not quite cuttable sharp, but they're near enough there. As I say, I've sharpened these. So, and what I'll do is I'll just lever the battery up and sort of, you know, cut away gently at the plastic adhesive. And normally, you know, I don't have a problem doing that. Yeah, so that's that. And then if it gets real difficult, I'll start to use, you know, this sort of stuff. But this is more like car battery stuff, if you have trouble getting car batteries out. But those mini pry bars do come in handy for levering the more heavy duty items where things have become really stuck and general purpose spudges just, you know, just won't move it. And I've got other spudges, levers and stuff as well. These are like solid levers too. Put like a center punch on one end and, you know, like a lever type chisel on the other end. So let's have a look at what I've got in my new bag of goodies here. As I say, these all came from Banggood and eBay, and I bought these, well, probably a month or so ago now, and I've opened a couple of them, so we'll see what we've got. First off, we've got these like star things. I don't know why they've got measurements on them, but I'm assuming that that's a good idea. If you're, say you're new to opening things up, you can tell how deep those things are going in, if you understand the measurements for a start, you know, so that you don't damage anything inside a device. They're also nice to hold these because they've got a thick, it's, you know, a thicker grip. Whether these grips normally peel off if they get any IPA underneath them, so it's best if you can try and keep those dry. But I've got a... how many of them did I get? 10, maybe. Yeah, I think I got 10 of those. I also got some more of these. I've had these before. These are like a credit card type, but a harder credit card type. And I thought I would use these for batteries as well. Now, remember me saying I use those for batteries? Well, these are very similar. Quite a narrow edge on one side there, and quite thick on the other side. So they have got thin and thick, two thick edges and two thinner edges. So, but just because of the size of those, they would be good for, you know, iPhone batteries, that sort of thing. So they're good, and they're, as I say, a lot stiffer, those ones as well, so those will be nice to use. And I thought these were these look pretty good. I'm just going to see if I can find the opened ones. Oh, maybe I haven't opened one of them. And these are just, maybe this was unopened and I put it back in. But these are just very flexible tools. You can see they're like paper. They're probably about, I would say, half a millimeter thick. Same as those. That's just smaller, so it's, you know, it sounds different. But I'm guessing half a millimeter for those. In fact, let me measure them. I'm only saying half a millimeter because quite often, I think it was these. Maybe half a millimeter. Oh, actually 0.3 of a millimeter those steel plectrums are. So what's this sort of thing? Oh, 0.3 of a millimeter. So they are quite thin, thinner than I thought actually. these are 0.1 of a millimeter, so these are really thin. Oh well, that's a surprise, I didn't know they were that thin. And then I've also got this type of thing which has got a sort of handle grip type end on it, which you probably wouldn't use. You'd probably use them really close to the edges, but they're just metal, so they'll last longer. I'm sure this is really thin too. Yeah, this is, that's the narrowest one, less than 0.1 of a millimeter. Have I got any different ones? No, I think those are all the same, but those are the ones I thought I'd show you beyond the ones that I've already got. And as I say, these are all available online where you prefer to shop. So yeah, that's those. So now we'll move on to making my wires up, guys. And I have made these in the past, but with thinner wire, I believe. Anyway, what I'm doing is I am replacing my heavier, sort of more solid wire. This is solid copper wire, sort of, not solid copper, it's stranded, but it's it's probably 30 or 40 strand wire, so each, the wire inside is, you know, quite thick, relatively thick. They're sort of flexible, but you can bend them and they'll just stay in position. So what I wanted to do was make silicon ones just to plug into me test gear over here. So I've already made a set which I like. Actually, I've lied, these are the ones that were for me other power supply, my 40 amp power supply over there, and these are very similar wire to this, but these have a silicon coating, and I also always use these Hirschmann banana plugs, because these are the best ones in my opinion, the ones I like to use anyway. £5 for five. If you go to Farnell's, they come in packs of five, so you can buy as many or as little as you want, really, as long as you don't want less as long as you don't want less than five. So they can become quite expensive if you need loads of them. So what I'm doing is I'm swapping the wire over from this sort of flexibleness to that sort of flexibleness, which is proper silicon wire. Now this wire is the wire that's used for RC car batteries. You can get this in all sorts of thicknesses. It's 200 volt wire, sorry, it's 200 degrees C capable wire, so it's heat resistant. It's capable of 600 volts, and it's 45 amp wire, which is very similar to this. I can't remember if this is 30 or 45, but you can see it's virtually the same thickness. This silicon stuff's just a little bit thicker, but the silicon stuff is made up of many more cores. If you look in here, I can show you the amount of cores in that one. I think there's about maybe 50 core wire there. What I'll do is, let's cut the end open on it and have a look. Probably lying, there's probably like maybe 100 strands in there, but let's have a look. I think we're probably right, maybe 50 cores, something like that. You see? There's not that many, but I'm guessing 50, between 40 and 50 anyway. This stuff, which I've just recently got, I've had it previously, but I needed to get some more. And I'm going to show you, this is 680 core wire. I don't know whether you can see in there, but get it out of the light. But what I'm going to do is get a little bit of it. And that is the contents of a little bit of that wire. There's still quite a few strands in there. So I'll move that out of the way. There's still clumps of it there, but believe it or not, there's 680 strands of wire in there. You virtually can't see some of it. It's so thin. Pick some of it up. You can maybe see how they're just like hairs. The wires are literally just like hairs, and they are actually copper, but they are tin coated copper, which makes them easy to solder. Now I need to get every piece of this up, so I'm just going to hoover here, guys, because if you've ever had wire in your socks or in your feet, you'll know it's not great. Also, the reason you need to get every piece of that up is because you don't want that stuff landing on a circuit board or anything. You know, after you might have got stuck on your finger or something like that, and if it ends up rolling around on a circuit board in a phone or something like that, it can cause endless problems. I'll actually wipe this down after I've done this soldering too. Okay, so just before I start actually making the cables, I just thought I'd mention these Hirschmann plugs. I bought these probably 12 months ago. I bought some of these ones more recently, but I've noticed on the Farnell's website that I think I'm right in saying that when I bought these, well, I obviously copied this off a delivery sheet or whatever it was I ordered. And when I bought these, they were rated at 16 amp, and I assumed it was because of this little screw they have in the connector at the top there. Obviously, you can solder them in as well, but there is a screw just so you can screw down on the wires if you want to. But these ones were rated as 30 amp. These don't have a screw. They have a screw hole, but there's no threads in it. So you're just likely going to solder these in, which is what I do. So just so you don't go looking for a 16 amp variant of these on Farnell's, I've had a look today and I can only spot these with the screw in as being 30 amp variants. So whether they've upped the rating of these, I don't know, or there's been a printing mistake or something like that, or a spelling mistake on the website. But I've measured these and they're both exactly the same weight. So why the current rating would be any difference, I don't know. I can only assume that it was perhaps because this was a screwed connection, you know, as opposed to what would be a soldered connection in this one. So I'm going to get two of them, two red ones and two black ones. I did put the non-screw one back on here, didn't I? Yes, I think I did. Yeah. Okay, so that's that. Right, I'll just get all this mess out the way, guys. These are really good as well, these Hirschmann crocodile clips. I have these on all my test gear and stuff. They have the banana plugs on the end, so just plug them on and off when you're ready to go. These are just eBay ones that are used for the ends of probes. I don't think these are Hirschmann. I'm just looking for the little H. Because a lot of the Hirschmann stuff has a little H for Hirschmann. You can just see on there. I don't think they are, though. Now, these cables I'm making today, as I say, were just to replace those more solid cables. And I've already got me length of cables ready. This is just more stuff that I've got. So I'm making these about 1.2 meters long, something like that. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut around 6 mil off the end of each cable, being very careful not to break any of this inner core wire. If you're in the UK, I think you could probably get this stuff from all over the world, but I get my stuff from a place called the Component Shop on eBay. There is other places, I've had it from other places as well, so just look for the 12 gauge 200 degree 45 amp wire. You can actually see the copper in there looking at it across the light. So I'll do that. I'll do these two ends as well. Let's say about 6 millimeter, just so these can fit nicely into the Hirschmann sockets on those banana plugs in the back there. And these wires, this wire is the maximum diameter you'll get into those Hirschmann plugs too. And even then, you've got to, you know, really screw it up as tight as possible to get it in there and twist it while you're pushing it in, because you can see the size of the hole in that. And that's got to go in there. I'll get me very dusty stand. And we'll put that in there like so. And make sure the little hole in the top there is facing whichever way I'm coming in with the soldering iron. Okay, so I'm going to get a load of solder. And I'm going to put the, I'm just going to tin this wire in a minute. But first of all, I'm going to stick the soldering iron in the banana plug. And I'm going to wait till it heats up a bit. I'm going to fill this cup with solder until the flux starts to appear at the top like that, and try not to drag this soldering iron out too quick, because sometimes if it's all hot and you drag the soldering iron out too quick, you'll find the flux will pour out of that, or sorry, the solder will pour out of that hole. Now, because this wire is so thick on the end, it's barely thin enough to go into this hole. So what I have to do is tin it first. Just put a bit of, I'll just put a bit of flux on him. And if anyone wants to know, I'm still using the Amtec 213A, which I'm finding great. And I'm just going to let this flow a little bit, basically just to join these cores together. Okay, so it's all hot now, you can see it all melting down. I've got a very narrow focal point here, so I've got to be careful where I move everything to. I've got a very narrow depth of field rather, so everything will go out of focus real quick. So I'm just going to cut the very ends off this insulation, just so I've got like a taper, if you like, on the end of it. And the reason for this is so that this cup, or this rubber cover, slides over it nice and easy. What I found, that if you use like a silicone spray or something like that, it reacts with the silicone wire and this cover, and after a second it becomes like, not like glue, but it becomes stuck, even worse, you know, than it would be if you didn't have any lubricant on it at all. Okay, so before I stick the hand cream on, I'm going to get me tweezers, and I'm going to, because my tweezers are tapered, I'm going to widen this hole in this Hirschmann outer cover. I'm going to put a bit of the cream in said hole, stick them in there like that, and really push the tweezers into there so that it stretches it. I'm just going to leave that for a second. A little bit more cream, and this time I'm going to put the cream on the wire like that, on the very end. And quickly, before this has a time to contract again, I'm going to put that hopefully over there, so it's a real tight fit, and it's starting to seize up on it already. So just gotta keep, oh, I've kinked the wire a little bit, I hate it when that happens. Don't think it's too bad though, and it's still going through, so I think that should be all right. Okay, yeah, it's through there, it hasn't kinked too bad. I hate it when I kink the wire too much. I'll show you a piece of the wire after, when it's kinked too much, it just feels wrong. It feels like you've damaged the inner cores. Okay, so that's that done. I'm just going to give myself some more wire to play with here. And now what we have to do is get this in there. Sorry about the lighting going a bit dark, my hands are right in the way of the lights. And we are still in focus, so that's all right. I've got the focus locked on, so it should be all right. Okay, so our little trough is full at the top of this connector. And now what I have to do is get that in there, but I turn it anti-clockwise in my hands already. I've turned this clockwise all these little wires. I've turned them clockwise, so they're all rotating sort of that way towards the end. Now, before I put it in there, I've got to rotate my hand anti-clockwise and turn it clockwise when I put it into this molten solder. But to get it molten, I have to heat it up again. It's starting to become molten now, and it's, you can feel the solder softening. Okay, so now inside that sort of crucible, I would like to call it, I'm going to rotate my hands anti-clockwise, dip the end in there, and start turning clockwise as I push down very slightly. And there you can see it just go in like that and keep turning clockwise, and then pull the soldering iron out at the last minute so that it sinks right into the hole. And you can see the solder's just pushed out here, which is what we want. And then after 20 seconds or so, I can just loosen this off and we should have a solid connector there. It obviously needs cleaning up a bit, it's full of flux on the end. Oh, still hot as well. So that's that, and that's how I do those connectors. You see we've got a nice contact there. The insulation is right up to the connector. Now we have to push this, which is very tight, over the end of this plug again. So what I do is I get a load of IPA and pour it at this angle into the, so it's all full of IPA. Get my fingernails behind this and start to pull, just so the cable starts to, or the outer cover starts to move, like so. Now that should all be covered in IPA inside there, and we can now just push it and twist very lightly. And see how tight that thing is, until it goes over. We're still tight until that hole is perfectly in line there, so we can get another banana plug through it, so we know that that cover is now on properly. And there you can see we have, you can actually see the little kink I was talking about in that wire now, but it's not too bad. It's not like it's not really kinked, and it will be getting flexed here anyway, so nothing too much to worry about. But that is a done plug, and that's how I do them, guys. So I thought you'd like to see how I make my own silicon cables. Okay, so just a couple more for me to do and that'll be it. I'll tidy up. So that's the video for today, guys, and I'll say thank you again for watching, and I shall see you in the next one. Thanks, guys, take care.